Okay, welcome to another video from the Health Ministries Department at the Pasadena Seventh-day Adventist Church. Let's go ahead and begin with a word of prayer. God of grace, we're thankful for today. We're thankful for life, Father, and we're thankful, Lord, that you are a God of mercy and grace. Bless us now as we go through this information. Help us to be informed and inspired. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so today we're going to talk a little bit about flattening the curve and treatments for coronavirus disease 19. If you were to take a brief survey of the internet, you will find that there is a hashtag that appears to be trending, that is flatten the curve. Well, we're going to take a look a little bit what exactly that means. We do have a lot of celebrities, even some policymakers, using this term, and we want to explore exactly what that means and how we can actually work together to flatten the curve. So the question is raised then, what curve are they talking about? What is that curve? To help answer the question, what is the curve, I want to bring your attention to this article published here in the New England Journal of Medicine, the title of which is The First Case of 2019 Novel Coronavirus in the United States. It's a brief case description of the first patient who was diagnosed and reported to have COVID-19, and this occurred on January 19, 2020. It's a 35-year-old man. He went to an urgent care in the Snohomish County, Washington. And he had a four-day history of cough and subjective fever. You can go through the article. I'm going to put a link to it in the description below. And it's a very interesting read. But I imagine that going forward, as we make it out of this pandemic, this article will be of some important historical significance. So it's probably a good idea to keep this and to read it just for your own posterity. So that raises a very important question. How do we go from one case diagnosed at the end of January to where we are today to well over 200,000 cases here in April? So what happened between January and April? That will help us understand the curve a little bit better. The answer to that question is something called exponential growth. Let's imagine you have three people, one of whom has coronavirus, and he comes into contact with two other people who eventually become infected. Then, each of these people go on to infect two other people, and the cascade continues from there. That's exponential growth, and that is primarily how viruses spread throughout our population. They're very good at this. So then it raises the question, why does SARS-CoV-2, which is the virus that causes COVID-19, why does it seem to be so contagious? The reason why this virus seems to be so contagious has to do with the ways that it could potentially spread. The first way is actually quite easy to conceptualize. If someone were to sneeze or cough, they would expel respiratory droplets from their nose or their mouth, and contained within these droplets would be virus particles that can travel a distance of about 6 feet before they eventually fall to the ground. If I were to come into contact with any of these droplets, and if it were to come in contact with my mucous membranes, specifically my mouth, my nose, or my eyes, then I would be at risk of developing the disease. Just a point to make though, if this were to land on my skin, and if my skin were intact, my skin would actually serve as an ample barrier to the virus, so long as I wash it off and don't touch my eyes, my nose, or my mouth. So your skin is a good barrier for the virus. Your mucous membranes, however, are not. Another way this virus can be transmitted is through aerosols and surfaces. Aerosols are smaller than droplets. Droplets are about 5 micrometers, and anything smaller than that is considered an aerosol. They're much lighter, they take longer to fall to the ground, but they still contain infectious virus particles. And then you have surfaces. This paper from the New England Journal of Medicine talks about a comparison between the aerosol and surface stability of SARS-CoV-2 compared with SARS-CoV-1, which was the other coronavirus that caused a pandemic years ago. And they took a look at this in aerosols and various surfaces, and they estimated their decay rates. And what they found was interesting. The SARS-CoV-2 virus, it remained viable in aerosols throughout the duration of their experiment, which was 3 hours. And if you looked at here, they talked about how on plastics and stainless steel, the viability of the virus was detected up to 72 hours. And then up here, on cardboard, it was 24 hours. On copper, it was 4 hours. So they found that the stability of SARS-CoV-2 was similar to that of SARS-CoV-1. So the stability of this virus is not all that different from the stability of the other virus in these experiments. So this indicates that the differences in the epidemiologic characteristics of these viruses probably arise from other factors. In other words, the reason why this virus is spreading so quickly probably has more to do with other factors besides aerosol stability and surface stability, since those factors are the same as the other coronavirus that caused the pandemic years ago. One of those factors is the presumed asymptomatic carrier transmission potential of this virus. In other words, this virus has the potential to be transmitted from people who don't have any symptoms. Asymptomatic means you don't have symptoms and you don't know you have the virus, but you still can transmit it to someone else. This is an article published in the Journal of the American Medical Association that talks a little bit about that. I'm going to put a link to this in the description below. And another factor that is worth studying is a new concept, or at least new to me, known as turbulent gas clouds. This article was brought to my attention by Ressa Ricaldi. Thank you very much, Ressa. She's the director of our health ministries department, and she shared this article with me, and I actually found it quite interesting. What they state here is that the current understanding of the roots of host-to-host transmission in respiratory infectious diseases are predicated on a model of disease transmission developed in the 1930s that, by modern standards, seems overly simplified. So this 1930s model they're talking about is the droplet transmission model and the aerosol transmission model. Here, what they're talking about is not just those two ways of transmission, but they talk about a multi-phase gas cloud, a puff, that entrains ambient air and it traps and carries within it clusters of droplets with a continuum of droplet sizes. So here you have a cloud, a gas cloud that actually traps droplets with a continuum of sizes, some small, some big. And this gas cloud and its payload of pathogen-bearing droplets of all sizes can travel 23 to 27 feet. So this raises questions about the amount of PPE that we should be using and in what proximity to the patients that we're treating as healthcare workers. And also raises questions about what we as the public can do when we're out and about going around shopping at stores and so forth. Is it necessary to wear masks? Do we have enough PPE for our healthcare providers walking around in certain parts of the hospital? So again, this is worth studying. It's worth looking into. We really don't know yet. And the authors conclude here that there's a need to understand the biophysics of host-to-host respiratory disease transmission, accounting for in-host physiology, pathogenesis, and epidemiological spread of disease. So lots more to be studied. So in summary, this virus here has the potential to be spread a number of ways. Here we have droplets and aerosols. The droplets can be transmitted for about 6 feet. Aerosols can last up to 3 hours, so long as they maintain their presence in the air or the atmosphere. And certain surfaces can carry the virus for up to 72 hours, which is why it's very important for us to be cleaning our surfaces and maintaining a clean home and clean work area. And then on cardboard or other papers, the virus can be viable for up to 24 hours. And here we have this new concept of a gas cloud that can travel up to 25 feet carrying infectious particles. So all these things need to be further studied, especially the gas cloud, but it kind of gives us clues as to how this thing is spreading so quickly and how it seems to be so contagious. With all that being said, now we get to the curve. And what curve is that? The epidemiology curve, or epi-curve, or some people say epidemic curve. And when you have a curve, you need to plot it out. It's basically a graph. And you have a y-axis and an x-axis. On the y-axis, you have the number of cases, and on the x-axis, you have time. And when you plot the number of cases against time, you get a curve that looks like this. The first part of the curve demonstrates the exponential growth that we alluded to earlier, and then eventually you have a maximum number of cases, and then people start to get better, immunity develops among the population, you have herd immunity, and the pandemic is over. An important thing to note about COVID-19 is the fact that not everyone under the area of this curve needs to go to the hospital. We have found that about 20% need to go to the hospital, and this is represented here by the black curve. And even fewer of these will need critical care or to be on ventilators. The thing about exponential growth is that it is a function of two main variables, E, the amount of exposures, and P sub I, the probability of infection. And so if you want to flatten this curve, if you want to reduce the exponential growth, what you really should be doing is focusing on reducing exposures and reducing the probability of infection. And every exponential growth curve has what's called an inflection point. The inflection point is the point at which the curve stops having a slope value greater than 1, and it starts to become less than 1, and then it begins to peak, and then it becomes a downward curve. So that inflection point is very important, because once the rate of change starts to decrease, then we start to feel confident about what we're doing, and we're noticing that the curve is starting to flatten out and eventually peak. And there is a very important reason why we want to flatten this curve. Of course, we all want this pandemic to be over, and we want as few people as possible getting sick. But on top of all that, there is another main reason, and that's represented by this line here. This blue line represents the hospital system capacity. This is the capacity that we have to take care of sick patients. This is determined by the number of ICU beds, the number of doctors, the number of nurses, the number of respiratory therapists, and all these other factors that make up what's called the hospital system capacity or the surge capacity. If in a pandemic, the number of cases that need hospitalization exceed the capacity, then you're faced with a very serious problem. And that problem is trying to decide who to save and who not to save. That triage process is much more complex when your capacity is overwhelmed. So it is imperative that we do our best to try to make this curve as flat as possible so that the peak of the curve, at least this black curve, falls under this blue line. Because what happens when it doesn't? You have a red zone here, and people in this red zone have less of a chance than people down here. And that's not what we want as a society. That's not what we want as a healthcare system. So what are some of the things that we're doing to try to flatten the curve? It's pretty obvious. The first thing is the physical separation or the social distancing. By doing this, what we're doing is we're trying to reduce this variable here, the amount of exposure. Also, we're trying to improve our hygiene. That's why everyone's talking about washing their hands. I would also add to keep your clothes clean, to keep your house clean, all these other various things that we do to maintain good hygiene. This reduces the probability of infection. And also, as we alluded to in the other lecture, we need to improve our immune systems. We need to optimize our immune system so that we can fight this virus. This also reduces the probability of infection. But that's not the only thing we're doing. Not only are we trying to flatten the curve, we are also trying to move this blue line up. We're trying to increase the capacity of our hospitals and our healthcare system to meet this challenge. And we're doing that by getting more hospital beds, more ventilators, medical doctors and staff, and so forth. And I want to highlight one of these efforts. The United States Navy ship USS Mercy is docked just outside of Los Angeles. And this is a floating hospital managed by the United States Navy. It's part of the humanitarian arm of our military and armed forces. And they go around, this ship goes around the world doing humanitarian service to many different countries that are in need of healthcare. And this ship actually has 1,000 beds. It has an OR, it has a CT scan. You can do a whole lot on this boat. And it's actually, as a 1,000-bed hospital, it's actually the largest hospital ship in the world and qualifies as probably the fourth largest hospital in the United States because of the sheer size and volume that it has. So it's right now docked outside of Los Angeles in the port of Los Angeles. It got here earlier this week, and the hospital that I work with actually is starting to develop a plan to transport patients from our hospital, non-COVID patients from our hospital, to be taken care of on this ship so that we can make more room in the ICUs and in the critical care units for COVID-19 patients. So I think this is very impressive, very inspiring, and I just wanted to bring that to your attention. Okay, so back to our epi-curve. So here we are working together to try to flatten this curve. And to say that we each have a role to play is a huge understatement. Our individual responsibilities to maintain social distancing, good hygiene, and a healthy immune system goes a long way towards flattening this curve, which could eventually save lives. And while we're doing this, we're also trying to increase this blue line. We're trying to raise this line up by increasing the number of beds, ventilators, and healthcare professionals that are providing care to COVID-19 patients. And by doing so, what we hope to achieve is this: a green curve that falls within the healthcare system's surge capacity, and a curve that diffuses the number of cases over time, because it's much easier to take care of patients sequentially, one at a time or a few at a time, versus a whole bunch all at the same time. So this is what we mean by flattening the curve, the importance of which has to do primarily with our healthcare system capacity and our ability to handle cases. This is an article from the Washington Post that shows that social distancing works. The earlier the better, California and Washington data show. So this is Dr. Brooks demonstrating how we are flattening the curve here in California. And I'll put a link in the description below, but you could take a look at these cases. And they show how certain events, certain efforts to try to flatten the curve make a difference. And in California, it does seem on some level that the difference is being made and that the curve is starting to flatten out. Maybe we really are reaching that inflection point, and hopefully going forward, we'll start to see fewer cases reported every day. Okay, so I want to switch gears a little bit and talk about potential treatments for this virus. Not only do we want to flatten the curve by using good hygiene, social distancing, and good immune systems, but for those who end up in the hospital, we want to give them their best shot. So we want to develop therapeutics to help them as much as we can. Now, I want to start out by saying that there are currently no FDA-approved treatments for COVID-19. The current guidelines recommend supportive care only, and that is done either at home or in the hospital. And in fact, most people are getting better on their own at home. Saying that, there are a few drugs that are being considered right now and they're being studied. And before we talk about those drugs, we have to understand a little bit about how this virus actually works. So this is your SARS-CoV-2 virus with its protein spikes, and it's an RNA virus, so it has RNA inside. And this is a human respiratory cell. The virus attaches to this thing called ACE2, which stands for angiotensin converting enzyme. Once the virus attaches, it injects its RNA inside the cytoplasm of your cell. Then you have an enzyme known as RNA-dependent polymerase, or replicase, that goes along the strand of RNA and makes a copy of it. And once this RNA is copied, a new virus is created and the replication repeats itself over and over again. There are several drugs being tested right now, but I want to talk about four in particular. The first one is called remdesivir. The second one is chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine combined with azithromycin and lopinavir with ritonavir, and then there's something known as convalescent plasma. So remdesivir, depicted here, is actually a medication that we've had for a while. It's been used to treat Ebola in the past. And the way remdesivir works is that it binds to replicase and halts RNA transcription. If you stop RNA transcription or replication, then you stop the virus. Chloroquine with azithromycin, depicted here as CA, is also being studied. Chloroquine or its brother, hydroxychloroquine, are very similar, and they are used to treat rheumatoid arthritis and malaria. Hydroxychloroquine is also known as Plaquenil. Azithromycin is an antibiotic. It actually does not fight viruses, it fights bacteria, and it's often used for things like community-acquired pneumonia, and some doctors prescribe it for bronchitis. Although it doesn't have any direct antiviral properties, it's been found to have an anti-inflammatory effect and also an immunomodulation effect. So sometimes we do use it in viral infections. The way that hydroxychloroquine is proposed to work or presumed to work is that it allows zinc to enter the cell. Zinc is a metal ion, and the cells in your body are surrounded by a phospholipid bilayer. This membrane does not want to let ions go through it. And so hydroxychloroquine has been shown to act as a passageway or an ionophore to allow zinc to enter the cell. And if the concentration of zinc inside the cell is high enough, it can also stop the DNA or the RNA replication of the virus. And then you have something called lopinavir and ritonavir, abbreviated LR here. Another name for this is Kaletra. It's an anti-HIV medication, and it's a protease inhibitor, so this also helps to stop the RNA replication process. The fourth treatment is convalescent plasma, or CP, as depicted here. Convalescent plasma are blood products derived from individuals who were infected with coronavirus, but then they recovered. And so presumably, they mounted an immune response and they produce antibodies. And if we take that plasma and we infuse it into another patient who has an active infection, the hope is that the immune system will be able to fight off the infection more effectively. So here we have four proposed treatments and the mechanisms by which they work. Okay, so before a medication is approved by the FDA to be used in actual patient treatment, it has to undergo the scrutiny of several phases of study. And the best type of study to evaluate medications is a randomized controlled trial. And a more robust version of this would be a randomized placebo-controlled double-blind trial. In many ways, this type of study represents the epitome of medical research. And the FDA relies heavily on these sorts of studies to make decisions as to whether or not a medication is put in circulation. So how does a randomized controlled trial work? Well, usually you have two groups. You have the intervention group and you have the control group. The intervention group usually gets the medication or the treatment, and the control group doesn't, or they get a medication that's sort of like a fake pill, a placebo that has no effect whatsoever. And then you measure outcomes between the two groups. And then you compare to see if there's any statistically significant differences between the two outcomes. If the differences are not statistically significant, then we say that the results of the intervention group are more likely related to chance. By the way, fun fact, do you know what the first randomized controlled trial ever was? Right here in the January 2003 issue of the New England Journal of Medicine, a physician writes to the editor and he raises the point that the first published report of a clinical trial has biblical origins. In the book of Daniel, reference is made to the unwillingness of the Israelite Daniel to accept the diet offered by the Babylonian king Nebuchadnezzar. And so right here, in a very reputable peer-reviewed medical journal, the book of Daniel is cited as having the first clinical trial. And the two groups in the study were Daniel and his friends, who ate only fruits and vegetables, and the rest of the captives who ate the king's food. And you can read the story for yourself in Daniel chapter 1. And you can judge for yourself whether or not the differences in outcomes between the two groups were statistically significant. Amen? Amen. Okay, so now we're going to take a look at the actual anti-COVID therapies that we briefly mentioned earlier. I made a table here that lists the drugs: remdesivir, chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine with azithromycin, lopinavir with ritonavir, and convalescent plasma. And we want to see whether or not these drugs have any in vitro activity. In vitro activity is basically, does the medication show effectiveness against SARS-CoV-2 inside a test tube? And then we want to see whether there is any observable benefit in actual patients. And then we want to see whether randomized trials have demonstrated efficacy against SARS-CoV-2. So you can look briefly at this table and you can see that most show in vitro activity. There is some observable benefit with hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin, and it's making headlines. We don't really see any observable benefit with lopinavir and ritonavir. And actually, there has been one good randomized trial that actually shows no differences in outcomes. So this one is almost essentially ruled out. And with convalescent plasma, there is a precedent set in other pandemics, such as the other SARS pandemic, MERS, and even Ebola. And the last column is very important, the randomized trials. This will show us whether or not the medication has any real promise. And so far with all of these, everything is still in progress. So the question really hasn't been fully answered for any of these. This article from JAMA talks about 5 critically ill patients with COVID-19. They got convalescent plasma and they show that they actually had some benefit. All 5 patients were receiving mechanical ventilation at the time of treatment, and after plasma transfusion, body temperature is normalized within 3 days in 4 out of 5 patients. Other indices showed improvement as well, including viral loads being decreased. So this one might show some promise. And in this paper, which is looking at hydroxychloroquine with azithromycin, if you look at this graph very quickly, you'll notice that the number of patients with a high viral load decreases over time after treatment with hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin. Now, I want to point out that none of these are actual randomized trials. They are observational studies. And so this data doesn't really carry the weight of a randomized trial. So we really don't know yet whether there's going to be any true positive benefit from these medications on a wide scale. So more study is being done, and we will know these answers hopefully soon enough. Okay, so that's all I have for today. I want to finish by showing you a picture. This is a picture of an airplane full of healthcare workers from Atlanta, Georgia, who are on their way to New York to help fight coronavirus. Most of these, I believe, are volunteers, and this photo went viral on the internet. To me, this is very inspiring, that there are people out there who are willing to put their lives on the line to be part of the solution to this pandemic. So I want to express an extra word of gratitude to all my fellow healthcare workers out there who are helping to fight this thing. Thank you. Thank you to the ER nurses, the ER doctors, the ICU nurses, the critical care physicians, the pulmonary specialists, the infectious disease specialists, the respiratory therapists, everyone who is playing a role, even the first responders, the firefighters, the paramedics, the EMTs. Thank you for your hard work. Thank you for putting yourselves on the line. And I also want to add an extra word of encouragement too. This is what you train for. This is why you study those long hours when everyone else is out playing at the beach. You were made for moments like this. So keep at it. Don't give up. God has called you for such a time as this because the world needs you now. Thank you and God bless. Thank you for watching. Next week, I hope to talk about coronavirus and pregnancy. It's a very important topic and it hasn't gotten a lot of press, but we definitely want to bring it to your attention. With that, let's end with a word of prayer. Dear God, thank you so much for guiding us through this pandemic. I want to ask for an extra special blessing on those healthcare workers out there who are involved with the fight. We pray that you will give them strength, give them rest, give them faith and courage. We say these things in Jesus' name. Amen.